In this lecture, I'd like to talk about collaborative consumption and the sharing economy. The basic idea of collaborative consumption is that there are resources that we as individuals own and or control that have excess capacity and are underutilized as a result. And because of our inability to share easily, we buy far more capacity, generally speaking, than we need just in order to make sure that we have access to the services that we need when we want them. So this sharing, it's hard. We will overbuy our resources and we'll oversubscribe so that to make sure that we're never without a resource that we want. So let's ground this with a particular example. And this example will be of Zipcar. Some of you might be familiar with Zipcar. The basic idea of Zipcar comes from the observation that a typical car sits idle almost 23 hours out of the day. So the folks who founded Zipcar thought, what if instead of having that car sit idle, we just shared the cars so that those 23 hours were being used rather than just sitting around creating capacity in cars that we weren't using? Well, we could own less cars, we could get greater efficiency out of the cars that we do own, we can create a community, and we can do something that creates a more sustainable environment for everyone. Well, that's basically what Zipcar's ideals are. When you want a car, you use some technology, you use their app or you use a website to reserve the car online. And when it comes time for you to use it, you take a physical RFID card key and you use it to unlock the car by waving it on a sensor on the windshield of most cars. Waving on the windshield causes it to unlock. You drive it around for the period that you reserved it. Zipcar pays for the insurance, they pay for the gas, they pay for the cleaning, they pay for maintenance, they pay for parking at the spot at which the Zipcar resides, at the pickup point. And when you're done, you return the car to the location in good order, and voila, you've eliminated your need to own your own car if you live anywhere near where a Zipcar is available. So it turns out that I'm one of those people. I'm in a family of six people. We have one car, and for any extra car capacity that we need, I use car sharing, and in particular Zipcar. This is great because although that one car that we have gets used pretty often, more than 1 hour a day, because it's not used for commuting, it's used for running kids around all over the place and doing errands. And I rarely need another car, but occasionally I do. And fortunately, I live in a location where there are probably six or seven Zipcars within walking distance, and probably 15 if I'm willing to ride my bike to pick up a car. So I'll often use car sharing in order to augment the car capacity of our family. Well, to make this work, of course, there are a lot of details that need to be attended to. For example, how do you pay for the car? Like, how do you, as a consumer who's part of the Zipcar environment, pay for it? Well, in Zipcar's case, it's hourly. That isn't always the case with car sharing organizations. Who's going to clean and maintain these cars? They're all over the place and it's hard to get to sometimes, and they need to be in clean and well maintained in order for people to want to use them. So it turns out that in Zipcar's case, they outsource this to third-party companies that are sort of unbranded. And in fact, I've come across them a few times servicing the car, and they kind of reminded me of like magic elves that come and scrub the car and change the oil and do all kinds of things you need in the dark of night. What happens when you get in an accident? What happens if you don't return the car on time? There are a lot of details, but Zipcar's managed to finesse a lot of them, and for the most part, this whole arrangement works pretty well, surprisingly well, actually. They reasonably estimate that owning a car costs about $8,000 a year. They have a calculator online that you can go check for your particular circumstances how much car owning costs. So they estimate that it costs about $8,000 a year, and depending on how often you need the Zipcar, it can cost you about $1,000 a year instead to use Zipcar. Their calculator is very good for figuring out if it's a good economic decision for you, although economics may not be the only thing that's motivating you. Convenience, environmental impact, credit may all be issues that prevent you from owning your own car or wanting to participate in Zipcar. So although it isn't a perfect match, you can also consider, although it's not a perfect analogy, you can consider Zipcar to be like an hourly car rental arrangement. So in addition to the economics reasons, there are other reasons why you might want to share, and the screenshot sort of points to some of those. But you can imagine that the economic impact of having 21 cars for 20 families, meaning one car per family and then one Zipcar, instead of having 40 cars for 20 families, so two cars per family, that's pretty big. And so the impact of what Zipcar can do in reducing the car ownership is pretty substantial, depending on how you use your cars. Well, not surprisingly, Zipcar isn't the only car sharing service that's out there. It turns out that there's quite a few of them, internationally and in the US, and each of them kind of have their own unique model for their take on what car sharing looks like. Car2Go is an example of another car sharing service. This is a car service that eliminates the idea of having a parking space. So with Car2Go, you can just park the car anywhere that it's legal and walk away. Someone else who wants to use the car is just going to pick it up from where it's currently parked, or Car2Go people will reposition it into a more distributed location. This is a way of keeping cars in the environment, not necessarily having a specific place where they live. Kind of like maybe you see bike sharing kind of works this way in Portland, Oregon. Another type of car sharing is called ZEVnet. And ZEVnet manages zero emission vehicles, so pure electric vehicles, and they keep them at commuter rail stations. So person one drives to the train station in a ZEVnet car and takes the train to work, whereas person two arrives at the train station and takes the car that person one drove to the station. Person two takes it from the station to their work. And at the end of the day, person two takes the car back to the train station, and person one takes the car home at night. It's an interesting take on using commuter trains when you have people that are going opposite directions and would otherwise need some way of getting to and from the train station on their own.